right. Okay, I have developed a topic which is, I thought it's going to be one-time preaching. But as I go deeper and deeper and digging, I managed to make a 4 series of these teachings. And I don't want to lose all the important ones, because I believe that the Lord has given it to us so that we will have full knowledge and understanding of how He has ordained everything, or we will have deeper understanding of what the Son of God has done for all of us. But before that, I have to give you the foundation. So I will be teaching only the first part, which is, it's all about sin, transgression, and iniquity. Part one. Okay, I believe that you have been encountering, when you read the Bible, if you're reading the Bible, you will notice that sin, transgression, trespass, iniquity have been used, and sometimes they are used in a different ways. It's because I discovered that these three, or these terms that was used in the Bible, communicates the same thing, the same idea. And it's all about the act of doing evil and lawlessness. So sin has many forms, in the sense that it only differs in the level of disobedience. Are you interested? Okay, so sin, these are all sin, but with different type of level of disobedience. We can find iniquity, transgression, and trespass. They are all pertaining to sin, but the progression or the weight is different. Okay? But I'm not going to that yet. I would like to give you the foundation first. How we got sin, where sin started, how did we acquire the sin nature, and what is the status of the human beings, the mankind now, before Christ and after Christ. Alright, in Micah verse 2, chapter 2 verse 1, you see, woe to those who plan iniquity, to those who plot evil on their beds. You know what? Whether we like it or not, there are people who are evil. Then yes, we love them, but if it's already evil, we cannot tolerate. And iniquity is something that being planned even before they go to bed. Intentionally evil, they're planning. They're plotting, and they carry it out. In the morning light, they say they carry it out because it is in their power to do it. That means they plan it. Woe to them who plan these things, you know, to plan evil in their beds, and they carry it out in the daytime, in the daytime or daylight. Right? So, what is sin? Ganda naman ako, no? What is sin? Okay, in Greek, I tried to research it. In Greek word, it is called hamartia or hamartia. You know, in Hebrew, it has three meanings. It is called in Hebrew, how do you say that? Kau, Chinese yata to. Kau, ka, kem. No, you read it, please. Kata, should kata, but kata. Yeah. So it's in Hebrew. Sin is kata, but it differs how they will use it, because it could be kata, could be transgression, could be trespass, could be iniquity. But they also have, the Hebrew word has very specific translation for everything that it has its purpose. And I was telling my brother here earlier, you have to change your name. You know, because in Hebrew, chapta means sin, trespass means pesha. It's all sin, under sin, trespass, to go against, to cross the line, pesha. Transgression is avera. Avera. And iniquity. You have to change this. Tawag means iniquity. Kaya Abigail na lang po ang pakitawag kay Pastor. Pastor Abigail. So, it is all used in Hebrew sin, but there is a specific level of meaning. So, basically, sin is the general term, you know, it's a general term for anything that falls short of the glory of God. That's what in Romans 3:23, for all have fallen short, have sinned, and fall short of the glory of God. Lahat, everyone, fall short of the glory of God. So when you're short of the glory, it's sin, anything. So, but let me just discuss to you, sometimes the translation are not particular if it's talking about the sin committed in the past, like the imputed or the personal sin that you are using, or the sin nature. So we have, you know, if you have, I downloaded this application wherein there is a Hebrew, ano bang translation yun? I'll give you the application later. When I'm reading the verse, there is a Hebrew and Greek meaning. Because I understand, you know, in one word, there's so many synonyms. So it depends on how it was used on that specific verse. So we have to check which it is being used for. That's very concordance. It's not like a concordance, but it's a Bible with Hebrew and Greek meaning. It's free in internet. You have to download it. Right. Now, so to be specific, to be clear, you know, what do you mean by sin? Sin is like this. The meaning of sin is to miss the mark. You know, if it is the target, you miss it. So if you did not, get the target, you miss it, you sin. Let's say, it can refer to doing something against God or against a person. And to miss the mark, it's like a failure or being in error. It's sin. So, pag hindi mo tinamaan, you missed it, you did something wrong, it's a sin. Okay? Is it clear? Okay. So, to miss the mark, there's one verse in the Bible, it's a story about Pharaoh. So, when the Egyptian people were, or Pharaoh, the ruler of the Egypt, when, during the time of Moses, wherein Moses came to, the Lord told Moses to allow, tell Pharaoh to let the people go so that they will worship him in the wilderness. So every time that Moses will go to Pharaoh, he will say yes, but then he will change his mind and stop the people from leaving. And one time, the Lord already gave Egypt 10 plagues before he said yes. He finally let the Israelites left. So there was one time when Pharaoh, repented, changed his mind. This verse says in Exodus 10, then Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron in haste and said, I have sinned against the Lord your God and against you. So it's like missing the mark is something you did not do it right. Because the Lord told Moses to tell Pharaoh to let the people go, but he would not let the people go. Amen? So missing the mark. What else? What are the other meaning of the? There's so many definitions of sin. I will just spend my time defining this, so that we'll have clear picture. So, not all the time. So, doing the opposite of what is right is also sin. So that means left. Okay. Galatians 5:17 says, the flesh lust against the spirit. The spirit is the Lord, the spirit is good, the spirit is God. If you go against it, you're sinning. So the flesh says there, the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. You want to do good, but you can't, because the pull of the flesh is really strong. That's why the Bible says, if you are led by the Spirit, it will be eternal life. You will reap eternal life. But you are, if your mind is focused on the flesh, it will reap death. Death. So, doing the opposite of what is right, if you know already that is right and you do the other thing, you sin. Again, failing to do something you know is right. Did you understand that? This is also another thing. You know it's good to do it, but you did not do it. You're sinning. You have knowledge of the good thing, but you're not doing it. That's also sin. Let's say the Bible says, is it good to forgive your enemies? Is it good to forgive your families? Is it? Therefore, to him who knows to do good, you know, and does not do it, to him it is sin. So that means failing to do, or you did not do. The other terms, you did wrong, it's sin. You did not do, sin. Saan tayo ngayon lulugar? We are all guilty. Look at this. We think that, sasabihin natin, sometimes, kanya-kanya, di ba? Walang, how do you say that? Basta ganong trip. But look at this. When you're doing something that will have negative result, it's also sin. Look at that. A little sleep, a little slumber, tulog ng tulog, a little folding of the hands to rest, so shall your poverty come like a prowler and your need like an armed man. So if there's a negative result, that's sin. There is sin behind. You get that one? So I know you will understand. If there's negative effect, that means behind that there was a violate, there was a, you missed a mark, you missed something, you did not do good. That's why there is a negative. So negative result are result of sin, fruits. Transgression of the law of God. Again, transgression is committing. I will explain to you later the next topic, what is transgression and iniquity. I will just give you some idea. So transgression is like doing it even if you know it's wrong. You still do it even if you know it's wrong. So transgression of the law of God. You know already the law, you know already the truth, but still you're doing it. So whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness. You don't honor the law, you don't care. Sin is lawlessness. So that's sin. Transgression of God's law. Rebellion against God. This is also one story wherein during the time of the Egyptians, also when they departed from the land of Egypt, and the people murmured against God, disobeyed Moses. There's so many things that they rebelled. That means you went against the will of God. People asked for a king when God wanted to rule Israel with judges, with himself, with prophets. But people were asking for a king, and that's why it's a rebellion going against God. Amen. That's rebellion. You are not obeying. You wanted to do other things than what is the will of God. That's sin. Can you please read that one?
Remember, do not forget how you hold the Lord your God, to grab at the wilderness, from the day that you parted and from the land of Egypt, until you be the days that you have given your bellies against the Lord.
Amen. So it was, they went against the Lord. So they are, if you're rebelling to the authority, rebelling, going against what is the authority, the law, you are sinning. You want to know where sin started? Grabe. The beginning of sin. Okay, let's go back to the history of creation so that we will get an idea where we got this nature, how we acquired, why we became sinner. The Bible will tell us, you are not sinner because you committed something. You are a sinner because your nature is sinful. Your root is sinful. So this is the story. The sin begins with Lucifer. Do you know Lucifer? Lucifer is an archangel. When you say archangel, he has a rank, like a battalion commander or something. He was an angel delegated with authority. So angels were given delegated authority. Delegated means God can still take it back. Amen. For the people, for mankind, when God proclaimed dominion and authority over us, he did not put any limit. And that's why sin begins with Lucifer, because he saw God. He saw the power of God. He saw the throne of God. That he began to have a jealousy and envy. That's what he said. Can you please read?
How your wonder from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning, how you are cut down to the ground, you who weaken the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation, on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
He wanted to become like God. You know what? Sin starts with, you know, what's in your heart. He already premeditated everything. He wanted to become like God. He's got this feeling of jealousy. And he knows that he will never defeat God, because God is so powerful. And then the story goes, because people are saying, where did Lucifer commit it? Where did Satan commit a crime? Is it in heaven or on earth? If you will, according to my research in our doctrine here, we have found, realized that when Satan, when Lucifer was assigned to look after Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, that was the chance that he committed rebellion. He committed rebellion when he was in the Garden of Eden. There's some proof that in Ezekiel 28 you can read. But first, he was still Lucifer. He was an angel. Amen. But when he became Satan, that's already when he rebelled against God. So, sin began with Lucifer. And Satan brought it to human race. Why? How? It was the time when the serpent, because you will read in Hebrews chapter 1 verse 14 that angels were sent by God to minister to those people who are being saved. And we understand in Ezekiel 28, Lucifer was sent in the Garden of Eden to look after them, to minister to Adam and Eve. But then Lucifer Lucifer, or before Satan, he was Lucifer, he saw the limitless power and authority of human beings that was given by God. He cannot defeat God, but he saw the chance, the opportunity of taking the power here on earth. Did you get that one? So, then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die, for God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." He tempted the woman to eat the fruit, which fruit was forbidden by God. He said, "You can eat any tree, the fruit of the trees." Can it eat the tree, by the way? But except for this tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Because the moment that you eat of it, you will surely die. And then the story goes that Eve was tempted, the serpent, which is the Satan. You know, that's why we always understand here that only the one with this body, earthly suit, yung tapikin mo nga katabi mo. May body siya, di ba? He has flesh covering. Anyone who has this flesh, or anyone who has complete dimension, spirit, soul, and body, you were part of, you were given, you were one of the recipient, you were given the authority to rule here on earth. Dominion and authority were given to those people who have three dimensions. And that's why Satan was spirit. That's why he pinatulan niya yung serpent. He went inside the serpent to talk to the woman. And that's why he's pathetic, because he doesn't have body. That's exactly why the enemy wanted to possess people. Because if they take over the body, they can declare, they can, you know, they have already the authority. They will have the right to command and to destroy, to uproot and plant, and to commit evil things. Because you are entitled now. If you have a body, that's your access. You understand that? And that's why you will see people are being possessed, are oppressed, and all this exorcism. The devil is really trying to, very hard, to take a body of one person. And people are deceived because they think that it's only a game. Sometimes they are really looking, asking. You know, many rock stars, many musicians they exchange their glory for that power. But they thought they don't have power. But we have received the power and not Satan. Amen. He was just a delegated angel. But he deceived people because people doesn't know about it. That's why it's deception. So what happens when Eve was tempted to eat the fruit from the knowledge of good and evil? Something happened that sin was passed down. So sin entered the earth. Through one man, the Bible says, through one man, sin entered the earth. And the wages of sin is death.
Amen.
When there is sin, there is an equivalent death. That's why the Bible says, through one man, sin entered the world. And death entered through sin.
Amen.
You got that one?
Amen.
So that's why when Eve committed sin, automatically there was already death. There was death. Sin, wage is death. Okay, in Romans 5, so sin was passed down to mankind from Adam. Because Adam was the one charged, because he ate also, not the apple, but the fruit. So, therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world, in Romans 5:12, and death through sin. And thus, death spread to all men because all sin. Kaya, supposed to be, we were not supposed to die. This body was perfect. We were designed, ordained to live forever. But when sin entered, then we become become corrupted, we inherit a sin nature. So, and for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. So, we now first, we inherited sin, means nature. So, that sin is called nahala in Hebrew. It is like inherited is passed on depravity. Depravity is corruption. Depravity is wickedness. So, that sin from Adam was passed down to all mankind. It is not imputed. Later I will explain what is imputed. It is only inherited through Adam. It's like, you know, when your parents, you inherit the physical traits, you know? So, you inherit it as it is. There is an inherent inclination, just told them. Yeah, inherent meaning natural inclination to sin because it's a nature. It is always easy to commit sin because this is your nature now, our nature. Says there, through Adam, sin entered the human race and human beings became sinners by nature. When Adam sinned, his inner nature was transformed by the sin of rebellion. Nakuha pa? Bringing to him spiritual death and depravity, the wickedness, by which it was passed on to all who came after Adam. That's why all humankind has inherited sin nature, because it was passed down to all mankind from Adam. We inherited that. That's why Solomon said, or it was David, surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me, talking about sin nature. Okay, sin nature. Your nature now, it is easy for you to commit sin because it is our inheritance. That's the fruit of the nature. Of course, if the nature is sin, the fruits are rebellion, the fruits are transgression, the fruits are committing evil, lawlessness. Ayan po no, sin, ang nature sin, natural, ang bunga niya ay puro kasalanan. That's why people are easy to commit sin than easy to do good. Amen. I always mention that even a child, you don't teach them how to do evil. You teach them how to do good. Because they already know how to do evil. A small child, they don't want to give. You know, a child, they don't want to share their food with, you know, sampalin ka pa niyan, ng bata. Because what? It is inherent. It is inherited. So, we have acquired that. The sin nature now is called the fallen human nature. Just as we inherit physical characteristic from the father. You know, yung mga anak, parehong ilong, parehong mata, parehong nagtataas ng paa. You know, from our parents. So, we inherit our sinful nature from Adam. So, the condition of all mankind is fallen. The fallen nature is equal to sin nature. Kaya lahat ng tao, ang nature makasalanan. That's why no one can tell you are a sinner because it's like talking to himself. We are all a sinner by nature. We inherited that nature. That's why every human being, every person, the sin nature is present. Being born from Adam, pinanganak ka, meron ka kaagad sin nature. It's already present. So sin leads to a downward progression. All tend toward, unless, alam mo yung, when you have the sin nature, you're being pulled to do evil, to do bad. Your tendency is always to lie. Tendency is always to do, you know, different from the will of God. It's okay, okay naman yan. You always cross the law. You don't obey. You want to, what you call this, experiment. Wala namang nakakakita. Something different. So, unless a person is restored, listen to this. Unless a person is restored by the Holy Spirit, he will remain being in his sin nature. Without being born again, a person will remain to be sinful. The nature is still operating in that person. So, what do you mean by propensity to sin? It's like the nature, it's natural. So our sin nature causes us to gravitate naturally towards selfishness. Diba? Ang dali-dali. It's like a magnet. It's easy to become selfish. It's easy to commit sin. You know what? The flesh loves sin. Causes us to gravitate naturally toward selfishness, envy, pride. Napaka-prideful. Hindi mag-sorry yan, hindi marunong. Kahit alam ng mali, talagang paninindigan. Why? Nature. Pride. And when we are trying to do good, nakihirapan. Because what? There is a law of sin inside a human person, a human being. That's why, in Romans 7, pag binabasa ko lagi Romans 7, I'm always confused because there's a verse there, you know, I did not put na kasi ang haba eh. Romans 7, verse 18 says, "For I know that good itself does not dwell in me." See, a person who has no spirit, a person who has not encountered Jesus, a person who has been born again, yung hindi nagkaroon ng bagong espiritu, yung same nature pa rin, sabi niya, dwell in me, is the sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. Kahit anong gawin mo, Monday, okay ka. Tuesday, mayroon ka na namang naiisip. Wednesday, oh, balik. So sorry na lang na naman ako. But the nature is there. It's not even removed. It's always going to happen. Because it's a nature. Something is wrong inside a human person. Everyone, anumang lahi, regardless of what nationality, there is a sin nature inside, dwelling in a person. Now, hindi ko nababasahin yung Romans 7 ni si Mara. No. Now, even before the transgression of the law were imputed to men. Look at this, I will explain this. The ultimate penalty for sin is death. Continued to reign. You know what? Do you know the meaning of Romans 5, 13, 14? I'm always stating this one. For until the law, okay, from Abraham to Moses, there was no law. Isn't it? So from them, there is only inherited sin. When the law was given to Moses, okay? When the law was given to Moses, nagkaroon na ngayon ng penalty every time you commit. That time, from Adam to Moses, even if you commit sin, there is no penalty. But there is fruit of death. Get that one? Wala kang binabayarang bull or sheep. You don't offer anything. There is no penalty. But your nature, you are receiving, you are reaping death already.
Amen.
It could be the death, spiritual death in your generation. You don't know, you are not feeling anything, but the effect is taking place already. Death has been spreading, probably in your generation. Though, so even if there was no law, death was already reigning. This is what it means. So, until the law, sin was already there. Isn't it? People are committing sin. People have inherited sin, but they were not charged. There is no charge. Because For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Walang law eh, walang basihan ng violation. Nakakuha natin? So even if you commit crime, you know, that's why Cain, he murdered, but he was not charged. There is no law. But he reaped many bad things in his life. So now, nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who had not sinned according to the likeness of the transgression of Adam, who is a type of him who was to come. So lahat ng sumunod kay Adan, ang death nagreign. Even there was no law yet. So now we go to imputed sin. The first one was inherited sin. That's nature, by nature. Nakuha pa? Number two type of sin is called imputed sin. What do you mean by imputed? Imputed is taken from an accounting. Sino mga accountant dito? So when you say you impute, you charge to one's account. Transfer, like credit card. You use the credit card, it will be imputed to you later. It will be charged to you. So, in Hebrew, it's called Lugi na kaagad ko. Lugi zomai. Shopai. To charge to one's account. To charge to one's account. It's like you take something that belongs to someone and credit it to another's account. It's also imputation, imputing. Okay? So, maliwanag ang imputed sin. So, now, after Moses was given the law, sin that was committed when the law started to be given, every sin that was committed within that period was already imputed to you. Imputed to human kind. May bayad na. May charge na. So, that's the meaning of imputed sin. After the law, sin committed in violation of the law were imputed to them. Charged to them. So all humans from Adam to Moses were subject to death even without the law. Tama?
Amen.
Because the wages of sin is death. Even if there's no law, nagde-decay na ang tao. Death, you have been reaping death in so many forms. Not because of their sinful acts against the Mosaic law. It was which they did not have, but because of their own inherited sinful nature. Nag-deteriorate ng tao doon pa lang sa inherited nature. Now, one type of sin is the imputed sin, the more na nag-deteriorate ang tao. Because of guilt sa inherited sin nature, meron ka pang imputed, violated mo doon sa law of Moses, you are charged with imputed sin. Because of the things you did not do in the law, you are charged. You did not obey, you are charged. You break it, you are charged. The sin now is imputed to you, charged to your account. Okay, so after Moses, humans were subject to death because of inherited sin and imputed sin. Dalawa na kaagad ang score. From violating the laws of God. So, ang isang tao, hindi may pinapanganak, may dalawa ng charge. The baby, the child who has been born is already guilty of the inherited sin nature and the imputed sin from the Mosaic law. Okay, now, let me share with you the principle of imputation. Di ba alam niyo na yung principle? You already know when it's a principle. It works. It is valid. It is for all time. It's a principle. God operates through principle. So the principle, listen to this because this is very important. You will share this to your family and you will understand it to yourself also. Why you are like that. You will understand our nature, I mean. Why are you? Nanginitan na. May isip ba dito? Okay, the principle of imputation, listen church principle of imputation means because of have you known Moses?
No.
We were not there, yeah? Yeah? When the law was given to Moses, we are not yet born. But you are charged. There is an imputed sin in you because of the law. You are charged even if you are not there. You're guilty of the Mosaic law even if you did not commit it because it was imputed to us. The good thing, the good news, God used this principle to benefit for us.
Amen.
How? Look. In exchange, God imputed the righteousness of Christ to believers.
Amen.
And credited our accounts with His righteousness just as He had credited our sins to Christ.
Amen.
This is the exchange, divine exchange that happened on the cross. So we were imputed with sin that was committed from the Mosaic law, and Jesus, who did not sin at all, His righteousness was imputed also to us because He paid the violation of the Mosaic law.
Amen.
On the cross, He paid it all, so His righteousness was imputed to us the way it was imputed, the sin to us.
Amen.
Is it fair?
Fair.
What do you think, Tagalog? Excuse me, Brother Saji. I will tell it in Tagalog. And Brother Andrew. Pastor Ferdy, bahala ka mag-interpret sa kanya. Meron pa? Oh, just 1 second. I will translate it again. Tatagalogin ko lang para dun sa mga hindi umimik. Okay. Wala pa tayo sa panahon ni Moses. May kasalanan tayong naman na because of the imputed sin. Pag sinabing imputed, di ba sino charge? Charge ka kahit hindi mo nakita si Moses, kung hindi natin nakita yung mga tao before, pero guilty tayo. Until now, without Jesus, a human being is imputed with imputed sin. Now, ang ginawa ng Panginoon, because that was the principle, He used that principle of imputation when Christ came. When Jesus came, He became man, and He died on the cross, and the nature of Jesus is righteousness. He's a righteous. He's righteous. In this code. Isn't it? Jesus is sinless. His nature is righteous. Our nature is sinful. Now, when He came and died on the cross, He paid to redeem our imputed sin and inherited sin. And that righteousness in Him was imputed to whoever will believe Jesus.
Amen.
That's why righteousness is an imputed work of God through Jesus.
Amen.
You did not work for it. Righteousness is a gift through Jesus Christ. It was the nature of Jesus imputed to the believers. Only believers.
Amen. Amen.
Because you have to acknowledge that He is the one who really is the Savior. Now you were imputed with righteousness the moment you believe and declare that He is your Savior. So that is the principle of imputation. God used that. That's why in 1 Corinthians, 2, I'm wrong here, 2 Corinthians 5:21. Pakinote po, 2 Corinthians. For He made Him who knew no sin. Talking about Jesus. Father made Jesus who is pure, sinless, made Him to be sin, imputed to Him the sin. Made Him to be sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God so that we can get that imputed righteousness coming from Jesus. Isn't it? Please, let's give Him a clap. That is due to Him. I don't even have to say please, because it's your responsibility to say thank you and clap for him. Amen. Hallelujah. So imputing our sins to Jesus, so God used the principle of imputation to benefit mankind when he imputed the sin of believers to the account of Jesus Christ. I'm just repeating it. Who paid the penalty for that sin death on the cross? God treated Jesus as if he were a sinner, because he was, you know, those times when you were crucified, as if you have sinned. So he was treated like a sinner, but the reality, he did not commit any sin. It was just for the payment of our sin nature and imputed nature, imputed sin, mankind. So he treated him as if he were a sinner, though he was not, and had him die for the sins of the entire world. Not only for Filipinos, all humankind. He died for all men, world. He died for the world.
Amen.
Amen. 1 John 2:2, and he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. So people are fighting with religion, fighting who's right, fighting which way. But they are all included in the plan of God. The redemption of God was not limited to some, to few, but it was all for all mankind who will only believe Jesus, that he was the one who died on the cross and paid for the sins, the inherited and imputed sins that mankind have committed or imputed to us. That's why the plan of God is to redeem all people, to save all men. But because people, they have this sin nature, pride, and deception, they are blinded with the work of Jesus on the cross. They blaspheme him, they mock him, they laugh at him. They do not understand the essence of the cross. For them, it is foolishness. But for us who believe, it is the power of God unto salvation. So, you have to understand, noted that it was imputed but not inherited for us, for Jesus. Okay? Hindi siya nagkasala. It was only imputed. The sin was only in charge to him, imputed to him. But he did not commit it. He was sinless. He was innocent.
Yeah.
But that's why sin was imputed to Jesus, but he did not inherit it from Adam.
Yeah.
Why? You know why? Because the conception, that's why it's a virgin birth.
Amen.
There is no conception between a normal woman and man. There was no physical consummation. And you know what? It's because of virgin birth. You know that the child, the blood of the mother, do you know that one? Scientifically, how do you say it?
DNA.
DNA. Do not disturb. DNA ng isang bata is only through tatay, the father. You cannot trace it to the blood of the mother. And that's why Jesus, when he came, he was sinless, because the blood of Mary did not mix with his blood. And he was a virgin conception, virgin birth. God already knows that people will ask, why did Jesus did not commit sin? He was also born by Mary. But Mary, that's why it's a virgin birth. God is so good.
Amen.
This is very smart. So, it was only imputed but not inherited, because Jesus is clean. He bore the penalty for sin, but he never became a sinner. His pure and perfect nature was untouched by sin. He was treated as though he were guilty of all the sins ever committed by the human race, even though he committed none of them. That's what Jesus did for you and me, and for all who believe in him. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So there's one more type of sin. So what were the two?
Inherited
and imputed. There's one more. It's called personal. The individual sin you are committing now is also sin. Right? That's another thing. So what is personal? Personal is the daily. Every day committed by every human being. Yung everyday, hindi ka man nag-pray, you're sinning. Because God said, oh, love Him. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul. Sino ang nasa number one? Di naman si God, di ba? Every day, you're committing sin. Personal sin. Because we have inherited the sin nature from Adam, we commit individual personal sins. Everything from seemingly innocent and truth to murder, all types of sin is a personal sin. Committed now. Hindi sa panahon ni Moses, now. Now, our generation. We have our own personal thing that committed. Sin that we have committed. Isn't it? Agree. Now, the penalty for all the sin is death. We are all guilty of three violations. The inherited, the imputed, and personal sin. And we are all doomed to hell. We should be punished for all our sins. Tama?
Amen.
Is it right? We are all guilty. Ayaw niyo mo? Wala kayo. But it's the reality. It's the truth. We are all guilty. If you are not guilty, you should not be here on earth. I know. So, mankind, us, everyone, mankind, three violations. Three times condemnation due to inherited, imputed, and personal sin. Pak down. And for the wages of sin is death. But the next line is, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Buti na lang. Buti na lang dumating si Jesus. Otherwise, we will all go to hell. Because we all have committed personal, we have imputed sin, and we have inherited nature. Inherited sin. So, those who have not placed, look at this, tell your family, tell your relatives, okay, makita. Those who have not placed their faith in Jesus Christ must pay the penalty. Ayaw nyo kay Jesus, kayo ang ipako. For these personal sins as well as the inherited and the imputed, you are guilty if you do not receive Jesus, if you will not put your faith to your Savior, if your Savior is yourself, good luck to you. But Jesus came to save us, to redeem us from this inherited nature, imputed, and personal sin. That's why he said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whoever will believe in him will not be destroyed, but will have everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, let me show you what the Bible talks about judgment day. For those who will not put their faith in Jesus, this is what the Bible says. The white throne judgment. Revelation 20, 11 to 15 says, please read.
And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened.
Okay, this is talking about the judgment day. During the time when people will be judged, and they will be all gathered in front of the throne of God. And he says there, books will be opened. Listen to this. This is not just a story. This is biblical. This is truth. Be careful. Make sure of your salvation. And I saw the dead, please.
And I saw the dead, small and great, standing
before God. Sabay, sabay. Ulit, ulit.
And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened,
who's that? The writer of Revelation?
John
the Beloved. He said, God gave him the vision in the future. It was the time of judgment. He saw the dead. He saw the people who are dead already. These are the judgment time. He saw small and great standing all will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Every one of us will give account. After this, okay, how long will you live here? 70, 80, 90, bonus 100, sige. Ayaw mo umalis dito, ayaw mo mamatay. Sabi ko ngayon, ay bugs mo, nasa ano na, sa floor na, ayaw mo pa rin mamatay. We need to die. Because this body is not accepted in heaven. Flesh and blood is not allowed in the kingdom of heaven. That's why this physical body of ours should be replaced with glorious, glorified body.
Amen.
When we are already dead, we will be given a new body. It's called glorified body. That is your access to enter. Hello? Heaven. Sandali na lang. 10 slides na lang. So, this one that we are looking after, this one that we love most, it's all going to decay. This will finish. Kalas. Kahit anong ganda kukulungot, di ba? Ganda. Even anong kinis, even anong pahak. This reality, we will all grow old, whether you like it or not. And even people, they will grow old, but tomorrow you don't know what's going to happen to you. You may not go to that age anymore. You might not reach, I declare, wala dito. But this reality, even a baby who is just being born, dies. Who can tell that tomorrow you will be alive? You have so many plans in your life. Huh? Who knows? You don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. This is why God is saying, you are being boastful of tomorrow. Tomorrow may not come. Tomorrow may be too late. Maybe there's no tomorrow. May natulog lang, hindi na nagising. Naligo lang, natulo sa sabon, patay, nahuntog ang ulo. Dead. This is the reality of life. But God is already giving us all these words for our guidance. We have a Savior who paid for all our sins. It's already free. It is a grace of God.
Amen.
Available to all who will believe, who will put their faith in Jesus Christ. Ikaw, kanino mo gusto i-put your faith? Bahala ka. But there is one true God. Jesus Christ is the Savior. That's why He's called Savior. Savior means there is a danger. He's going to save someone. Because we are all in danger. That's why He's called Savior. He will not be called Savior for nothing. He will come to save us from this inherited, imputed, personal sins. Otherwise, we have to pay the penalty. Next verse, the sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. Mga namatay na nasa tubig, may namatay sa Hades, impyerno, na nandoon na. They will all be judged. They will all be delivered to give account. Who were in them and they were judged, each one according to his works. Isip kayo sa works, no? Tanong nila lang mamaya sa Q&A. So, then death and Hades were cast. Why are they already cast when without judgment? Because they were already judged. Those who are in Hades and those who are in the death were already cast to the lake of fire because they are already prejudged. When they died, they already have the destiny because they did not receive or acknowledge Jesus. They did not believe the Messiah, the Savior. That's why when they die, a person who did not accept Jesus, please close the door, accepted Jesus on the cross, what He has done on the cross is in danger of going to hell. they will be put to the lake of fire. This is not a joke, it is written. God already gave us this warning. Bible has been written long time back before you were born. We have no excuse, we know it. Then God said, and anyone, this is the thing, anyone not found written in the book of life will be cast into the lake of fire. Make sure that your name is written in the book of life. How? By receiving Jesus as your Savior.
Amen.
And you will be assured of your salvation. Because that Jesus died. It was not a joke when he died. He really died because it's a big deal. All humankind were saved, were redeemed through his blood. He's God. His blood is so weighty.
Amen.
So Jesus' death on the cross was sufficient to cover all sin.
Amen.
So remember John, when he saw John the Baptist, saw Jesus coming. He was with his disciple. And then Jesus was coming before the baptism. He said, the next day John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. When he saw Jesus, he already knew that he is the one who is going to save the whole human race from the sin that was committed by man.
Amen.
Thankfully, tell your seatmate, thankfully, inherited sin, imputed sin, personal sin, have all been crucified on the cross of Jesus. So our faith in Jesus Christ gave us the redemption through his blood. So in him, Ephesians 1:7, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Did you see the plural?
Amen.
The forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace.
Amen.
That's how God loves us all. He gave his son to save us from all this danger. And now, you remember, having wiped in Colossians said, having wiped out, tinanggal lahat, the handwriting of requirements against us. When Jesus died on the cross, he also removed the requirements that is due to us, that was against us, in which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross.
Amen.
Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom.
Amen.
For many. Many is mankind. He did not come to be king here. He came to be a sacrifice.
Amen.
He came to be the payment for, like a ransom, you know a ransom? When you have bought something, gusto mong bawihin ang dating mong pag-aari, you have to pay. Even for the penalty, for the interest. Jesus is the ransom. He, his life, was the payment for all the sins of all humankind.
Amen.
And in closing, I remember this criminal on the cross. He said, when Jesus was crucified along with these two criminals, the one of the criminals were mocking Jesus. He said, who were hanged, blasphemed him, saying, if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. Because why? Because you see, people, especially when you do not understand yet how Jesus saved us, how God ordained everything, we are so prideful that we think what we think is right. We think that Jesus must perform miracles before you believe him. But with God, believe first so that you will see the glory of God.
Amen.
So he says there, if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. But the other criminal answered, rebuke him, saying, do you not even fear God? He said, you are under the same condemnation, lahat tayo nakapako dito, na-crucified, but indeed, it's justly for us kasi gumawa tayo ng kamalian. For we receive the jury warrant for our deeds, but this man, But he was crucified for all of us. And people are mocking Jesus. People are just using the name of Jesus in like a cliche or an expression. They don't know that the blood of Jesus even redeemed him. It was given for him for his salvation. And that's why on the cross, then he said to Jesus, Lord, you know why this man was saved? Because he declared him as Lord. He believed him in his heart. Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. He knows, he believed Jesus. Even if he was crucified, he knows that he is king, he has a kingdom. And Jesus said to him, assuredly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. And lastly, even on the cross, he was thinking of us. He was still, his thoughts are upon us. Jesus was saying, Father, do not charge them. Forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And you know what? What Jesus has done for us, he's not really asking for anything more. But he wants us to be aware that there is a life that he changed us already. He gave us a new chance. He gave us a new opportunity. He died for on our behalf. He substituted this life for us all, so that we will become partners in the kingdom, so that many more people will come to know about what he has done, so that many more people will be saved through us. Morning time, the chairs are empty. We're enjoying, we're here. What about the rest? Who will tell them? Who will tell them of what Jesus has done? Who will tell them that salvation is available already? That his sins are already paid by Jesus? And that's why Jesus is saying, go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and I will be with you, even to the end of age. He wants us to remember all these things so that we will be used also for other people. And that starting of the forgiveness is given us so much that we will start again our new life with him, being, you know, in intimacy with the Father every day when we wake up, every day when we journey this life. You have to know that you have someone with you, in you, dwelling in you. That this life here is temporary. The life that you're enjoying, the life that you think this is it, is not it. There is a life better in the presence of God. In the time that when we die, all of us will die, we will all see each other in heaven. The church is being used to inform people of what Jesus has done. This is the embassy of heaven. The church should be the place where people will find the love of God. And we are chosen to be an instrument for each other. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let's give it.